Okay, let's go. So today I will just have to give you a few details of the modeling type we are doing so that you are able to do the assignment one, because we immediately jump in the practical work today. We don't have a theoretical period of a few days and then start practical work. We do it just immediately. So today I will have to focus on the, say, what is really needed for that. So that's the approach that we follow in this course is network oriented. It turns out that networks are a quite convenient format to model computational models, and that you can apply them in mental, biological, social networks, and they will have the form of temporal causal networks, what we call them. And we do something on analysis of behavior in relation network structure and representation by role matrices. That's a format in tables where you can use to specify networks in a very easy manner. And of course, you already today you will use the software environment. So the idea of networks is that you can address complexity by modeling them as interaction in networks. And that is not a simple issue, because a number of people of you will know that in the brain there are many cyclic patterns. There is a form of recursivity, no linear causality. The simple causality would be that you have just one chain of steps from the beginning to the end, but it's not totally not like that. So therefore you need specific means to that are a bit adequate to handle them, and networks, they really are a bit okay for that. So these are just some illustrations. So this is a citation from Shearer. So he also points at this recursivity, and that is no unidirectional way of the causality. So these are some other pictures. Well, maybe many do. Sorry? Was there a question? No. So the cyclic patterns of mental events, they also can be found back in the philosophy of mind. For example, this is a citation of Kim, who is a very famous philosopher. He says that a mental state can be characterized in terms of relations it mediates, where the inputs and outputs may include also mental states or sensory stimuli or physical behavior, and they form a complex causal network. And that's what the whole process is doing. So in fact, it relates a little bit also to the type of cyclic patterns that you see in the brain, but also they recognize that in philosophy of mind, and they see it as causal networks. So that's one of the inspirations to think of networks as a modeling format. So this is the example of the assignment zero that we have today. This is actually used in almost all philosophy of mind literature. This is a kind of standard example. If when they want to explain something, they use this example. So it works as follows. You put your finger against a hot pot, for example, so that you have tissue damage. You feel pain, and then you start to do some reaction. You try to escape from it. You do some other types of expressions of the pain. So that's a very simple causal network. This one causes that, and this one causes these three things. And that's, you will work with that today in the practical session. So that's the idea. And also Kim is emphasizing that you have a kind of circularity and you have things that loop back in a circle. So that these are typical things that happen in networks. And therefore, networks can be an adequate tool to describe such processes. We usually speak about mental networks in such cases. You also have the notion of cognitive modeling. Then you could say cognitive networks, but because you also have affective states and not only cognitive states, I usually use the word mental to cover both the cognitive and the emotional things. Okay, so this is another example. This is just an artificial example. You have some states in a network, another state, and these are affected by other states, and then you can have also a loopback. And the processing takes place all the time. Keep that in mind as your mental image of the whole thing. All these states are active all the time. They're not waiting for each other. So even if there is kind of starting by giving input, then these are immediately also active. Maybe they are not, they have no high activation level or even zero, but still it's parallel process. All the time is a parallel process because that's how things happen in nature and in the world in general. So that's for the mental side. For the social side, you can also address social complexity. This is an example of a small social network. Now the nodes are just person states, for example, the emotions of the persons, and then the connections, denote how they affect each other. For example, this person smiles and then this person also start to smile as a propagation of the emotion. So that's another way of using networks, but then we call it social networks. Both are in the course. And this is just another example. They just measured the interaction by telephone calls, and then they made this type of network, and then you see that there is not a kind of random structure in a network, but it is kind of grouped or clustered, and that's actually a very important property of real world networks in general. They call it sometimes small world networks or also scale free networks. That's typically a pattern that you see like here. Then you have a lot of connections in some areas and then less connections between them. So that will also come later in the course. Also how you create such things by simulation. So then you have clusters. These are clusters and bridge connections. The bridge connections are the connections between clusters. So next example is from the biological world. So we have a bacterial cell, E. coli. And then we have modeled that the main processes in that already some time ago. Then you have DNA, and then from that, depending on certain factors, you generate messenger RNA, and also depending on other factors, from that you generate a certain active enzyme, and then that generates the real flux of, say, the matter, the chemicals. But also there is another factor. So this is typically how it is. Of course, a very simple picture, simpler than the reality, but it gives the main patterns, the main causal pathways, as sometimes they are mentioned, they are called, how it can work. So this already gives a lot of intelligence in it. Eh? Like you can let depend on your context whether you generate the active enzyme. So therefore, it can be very sensitive to context, which is one of the important properties of intelligent behavior. So this is not even a very stupid like of behavior or processing. You can see, in fact, already see this as a kind of mental model as well. But this is completely in terms of the chemicals, of the substances. But there are also in AI, and some of you may have seen that, especially in the area of agent systems, that's called the BDI model, belief, desire, and intention models. That's actually just a mental type of model. And one occurrence of that is like this. You have a desire, and then you create an intention to fulfill that desire. Maybe you could have other intentions as well, but you make some choice. Then you prepare yourself to do the action that's intended, and then finally you actually do the action. And also here you let it depend on the other things. And actually these two models, they are practically the same. If you make these correspondences between the different states, then they have just the same structure. And that shows how networks are a kind of unifying way to model different things so that you can find a kind of essential structure in the processes that are also applicable in other types of processes. So that's also one property of such a format. Of course, this also applies to certain other formats. That's not unique for network, but at least networks also do that. Okay, so currently there is now a field called network science. There are even a number of journals. There is the journal Network Science. There is the journal Applied Network Science. Well, there's some other journals that have network science in the title. So it's a real discipline nowadays. And if, because of this unifying structure, you can just cross borders between disciplines. And you can also see it even in the roots. There are many different roots from different sciences, different areas, that all contributed to the, say, the formation of such a science called network science nowadays. Of course, also more recently, we have internet and social media that has given also a good push to that area. All these things also will be in the course, especially the social media things. So let's now focus on what how we define what a network exactly is, what characteristics is it having, and what do they mean. So, for example, how should we interpret what a connection is or does? Are all connections considered equal or not? These types of things. And what if there are multiple connections to one state, to one node? What should you do about that? Is a network static, or can also a network be change over time? So you need answers for that to have a more precise notion of network. And I give the answers that we put on this type of questions. If you don't do this in a bit more detail, then maybe you have the idea, oh, a network is just a graph, but that is not true. And if you assume that, then it's a very simple concept and you cannot express many things. So if you only consider the network has a nice graph representation, of course, that is interesting and good to see it. But if you only concentrate on that, then you have just a serious underspecification of the network. So therefore, you will see now a bit more what we do to have a complete specification of a network. So we consider that the connections between in a network, we are assuming they have some causal effect. They denote some causal relation. If connections don't do anything to nodes, yeah, then what would a network be? Maybe only an administration system or so. That's not the type of things that we are interested in here. So we assume that connections do something, and that means they have effect. They define how the nodes affect each other, and that's what we call a causal relation. Are all connections considered equal? No, we say the rates, there are rates of connections that can be different values, usually between 0 and 1, and they indicate the strength of a causal relation. So one can be stronger than another one. And what if there are multiple connections? Then we say, yeah, you should combine the different effects. If you have different effects on a certain node, then you should know how they work together, these effects. So you need something to specify. Therefore, we have some characteristics that we call combination function used to specify. You can just make addition a combination function, for example, then you add the effect. But that's not always like that. So connectivity, aggregation, that's what we call aggregation, this is connectivity. And there is still another one, that's the dynamics of the state. So each state has its own dynamics, and that is indicated by speed factors, and that's the timing. So this allows you to let the network work in an asynchronous way. If you don't specify different speed factors, different timings, then you automatically assume that your network works in a synchronous way, which is not realistic for most real applications. Okay, so these are the main characteristics, the main types of characteristics, and in specifying a network, we need to specify these types of things. And also, the characteristics themselves, they could change, and then we come to the area of adaptive networks, and that will come later. So, let me summarize this. We have states and connections. They describe the nodes and links of a network. We have connection weights, usually between minus one and plus one. And if they are positive, connections just between zero and one. So you can, you often use metaphor like pictures. For example, this one, this represents the connection weight. So how strong this connection is depends, that makes how this will move or not. So that's one thing. So that's the causal relation then through that connection weight. So another thing, the aggregation, then we have an aggregation function, combination function for the aggregation. And you can see it like this. There are multiple people here. Maybe there are even students, I don't know. But they do their best to have a joint causal impact on something, maybe other people on the other side. And then you have to aggregate all of them together. In this case, you can add them because they are forming almost a line. Then in principle, they add just to each other. So then the combination function would be just a sum function. So that's a kind of metaphor for this aggregation. So that's the aggregation and the timing. Well, something flew over the screen. You can consider that as a metaphor for timing. That's how fast things are going. So that's just all. If you specify these elements that we have here, the omegas, the C's, and the etas, then you define your network. And if you give these things to the software, then it runs automatically. So that's all. You don't need to program or anything. You can just specify these things. So you can consider that in a graph form as a labeled graph. So this is only the connectivity, only 1/3 of the characteristics, you can say. So if you want the full specification, you have to add the extra things like the weights here. Even that was not full connectivity, because the weights also relate to the connectivity. But then you also have to add the orders, the speed factors, and the combination functions. So then, if you put all these labels everywhere in the graph, this labeled graph is a complete specification. And then, now I put letters in it, but you can just also indicate by numbers or so, then to make a specific form, a specific design. So that's, you can keep that in mind. That's the mental image you can have about it. Okay, then inside the software, so you do not have to see that all the time. Only for some analysis later on, we can have a focus on that a little bit, but not too extreme. So this is, I want at least to show it, at least how it works in the software, but you don't need to program or to know how to program that yourself. So what happens is that the impact that one node on another node has depends on the activation level, because all nodes are assumed to have activation levels over time, and it depends also on the connection weight. And the impact is defined as just a product of the two. That also happens, for example, in neural networks and in other cases. So that's a kind of standard definition of impact. That's a single impact from one state, one node. We call nodes also states because they change over time. So that's then states or state variables is a more common term. So we often use them states. So this is only from one side, but you remember that you can have many impacts. So then you have this aggregation. So this is the aggregated impact. And what happens there is you take this single impacts from different sites. So this is from X1 and this is from some XK. You can have an arbitrary number of impacts. And then you just apply this combination function on it. So that's how the combination functions work. You just apply them. And then actually it's just like this. And then the update step, to simulate things, you need the step from t to t plus delta t from to the next point in time. And then this formula is used. I have a separate slide to explain that a bit more in detail. So this is just the formula that comes out of the characteristics. So you enter the characteristics in the software and the software itself places these characteristics at the right places and makes this formula out of it. And, but you don't see that, you don't need to see that. But let me explain at least that you have some idea of the background of it. suppose we have three states x1 to x3 that have impact on state y. They all have connections to state y. And then we want to define some aggregated impact on y and to see how it affects y. So we already know the aggregated impact. We apply the combination function on the single impacts. So we already have an idea about that. But suppose, as an example, these are the values of the activation values of these states x1 to x3. So different values. Then together they form some aggregated impact, and a kind of intuition behind it is that it's a kind of average of that. So in most cases, in many cases. So then you have an aggregated impact here, that's maybe somewhere here on this. And this is the current value of y. So the current value of y is lower than all these values. So it would make sense if it would go a bit up by the effect of these ones. And indeed that happens. So one very simple way of doing would be if it jumps at once in one step immediately to this value of the aggregated impact. Some approaches do that actually, but in our case we want to have this timing in a better way. So what we do is not doing the whole of this difference, not the jump to that value at once, but just a part of it, a fraction of it. And that fraction should depend on the timing, on the speed factor. So that's indeed how it works. So that point is defined like this. We take the difference, this one, that's the aggregated impact minus the y. This part is the length of this blue interval, this blue line here. And then we take only the fraction defined by the speed factor eta. So for example, the speed factor is 0.5, then you take only half of this step. Of course, in the next point in time, you take also another step again. So that makes a very smooth way of moving in that direction. So if the speed is very low, if you take the speed factor 0.1, then it will be a very small step. Then it will go here, for example. And then it will take more time to go in that direction. So that's how the intuition behind these things is, and that's also behind the formula that I have shown, because this is just that formula actually. So for the processing, keep in mind that all states are active in principle at all times, even if they only repeat value 0. So if this is a kind of process that comes out, then you have all these effects from everywhere, but all in parallel at the same time. These effects here are not waiting till this has come further. These already are there. So all things change every time. So that's also a kind of mental image behind the whole thing. So let me just give some examples of combination functions. A very simple example that's also even often used is the identity function. Then you copy in some sense the value of one state to another state. If you have only one connection between states, you can often use this one. There is the scaled minimum and scaled maximum functions like this. And with scaling factor lambda, you divide it by some scaling factor. They are often used in fuzzy modeling. There is a sum combination function, very simple function, just the sum of the impacts. These are these impacts, these single impacts. There is the scaled sum function, then you divide it by lambda. So these are just rather simple functions, but many functions are not so complicated. Euclidean combination function is a bit more complicated, you can say. Then you take the nth powers of all the impacts, and you take the sum of them, and then you take the nth root, but not before you have divided them also by a subscaling factor. This can also be used. In fact, scaled sum is a special case. If you take n as 1, then you have the scaled sum here. These are often used in social networks, actually. you can see this is, if n is 2, you can see this as a kind of factor addition for those who knows a bit more about factors. And they are also used in error functions and optimizations. So these ones, the logistic functions are often used. They are also used in a neural network for those that know a bit about that area. And this is the simple form. It has some disadvantages, as I will show later. And there is also the advanced form that has the less of these disadvantages. So this, I will also illustrate these functions in a bit more detail. So these are just this is just the value at zero of that. And then that's to correct that for zero, it should be the right value. So they are often used for neural network models. So we have a library of combination functions. You can find that in the software components. And to successfully run any of the other templates of the software environment, you always have to put this library in your MATLAB accessible directory. Otherwise, it will just start to complain that MATLAB cannot find the right functions. Two functions that are a bit practical, that's for just in generating external input. If you want to repeat an experiment a number of times, for example, in a learning process, you have different trials over time, then you can use the step mode function, that is first zero and then steps to one after some time delta, and then it repeats the whole thing after some time rho. That's what the function does. And we have the step mode op function that does the opposite. It starts at the one and then goes to zero after some delta time. But that's not really part of the model, actually. It's only external input for your model. But you still have to do it if you want that input. So that's also in the library. So let's just consider the logistic functions. So we will use them today. This pain threshold, for example. If you use it for a logistic function, you can just use this threshold parameter of this function for modeling this pain threshold. So that will be done in the practical session. So this is one pattern. So then on this side, you have the you have the sum of the single impacts, and then on the sum you apply some curve that it stays below the one, because otherwise you get it anywhere. So it's always convenient to have your model staying between zero and one. So that's just take the sum. It's client, in fact, a kind of adapted version of the sum function. For the sum function, you would have a straight line, but then you go to high values and maybe you don't want it. And this cuts it off in a certain smooth way on the 0-1 interval. And the steepness is how steep this is. So if I take steepness, not 10, but 2, then it will be more flat. I will show it in a while. So now steepness is 2, and you see it's almost linear, and then only it helps you in staying behind under the 1. But now we have a little problem here. This is not plausible. You cannot justify this difference, because if you have no impact that's coming in, why would there be any activation out of nothing? So that's the reason why this function is not so good. And actually here in the previous picture, when the steepness is 10, it looks like it is zero, but it is actually not completely zero. You still have a little bit of activation there. But then it's so small that maybe it can be neglected. So if you use this function with very high steepness, especially 20 or maybe even 50 or so, then it's fine. It's not a problem at all. But if you use a more smooth variant with lower steepness, then this really becomes a problem. Therefore, the other one, the more complex formula, the advanced logistic function, is better, because then it's just like this. If you do the same settings, then it's really zero here. And the rest of the curve is just a bit similar. By the way, these combination functions, I told you they are in the library. And in principle, for each node, you select one of them, but you can also select more than one. You can also select two or three or even an arbitrary number if you want. And what the software does then is it takes just the average, the weighted average. So you can have weights, you specify them by weights. I want 0.5 of the scale sum. I want 0.7 of the logistic one and maybe 0.8 of some other function. Then the software will just use the average, the weighted average. But you don't need to know this formula. You only need to know that you can use a combination of basic combination functions, because the other one, we call them basic then, and these are more complex ones. Okay, so the software environment, it automatically translates the conceptual representation. So the conceptual representation is just specifying all these things, the connection weights and these things, and the speed factors, and also the weights of the combination functions. And so the rest is done for you by the software, and the simulation that is run, you can just get graphs out of it. I will show it in a minute also from the software itself, because of course I also have that. You can do some parameter tuning with respect to empirical information. That's assignment 10, it comes a bit later. We can also use self models for adaptive networks that will come next week. So there are many things, but this whole software does a lot of things. But for the first week, we only use part of it. So let me see. So this is the role matrix format. This is the format that you should get accustomed to. So what you do here is to specify these characteristics. So we need the specification of the connectivity characteristics, of the aggregation characteristics, and of the timing characteristics. So this is a very compact form of a table that specifies which state is connected to which other state. Here you see, for example, the third one, that's R, and that has the in the numbered line, it has number 3, x3, that it has influence, it has effects from x1 and x2. So there are connections from x1 and x2 to x3. So from P and Q to R. Well, indeed, P and Q to R. R has indeed as incoming connections these two. So that's specified here. Be aware that this is not what sometimes traditionally is used, what is called an incident matrix or a connection matrix, because then you would have not only an axis here of 7, but also an axis there of 7. And then you have a lot of empty places where there are no connections, and that's not so compact. So therefore we choose this type of representation, which is more compact. So therefore you have just after at each, you have rows for each state of your network. And in that row, you just specify what are the things that impact the state. So these are things that have impact on that state. So this is the connectivity. This picture is actually just equivalent with the image information in this this picture here. So this table is a representation of this graph. And because there is a lot of things that we add here, you will see that this indeed is only a small part of the whole specification. So of course, the next part is that we also need connection weights. So each of them should be have a number. So then you have a kind of copy of this table, but then on each place, you just set a number. In this case, it's a simple example, it's just one. Then we have a speed factor, and then just for each of the states, we give a value. So these are the connectivity matrices, the connectivity characteristics. This is the timing characteristics. So So now we go to the aggregation characteristics. It's also very simple. We need connection, a combination function weights. That means for each combination function that you use in this model, you have to specify whether you select it and by which weight. So this you specify here that you select just this function. And you in a separate place, you define which functions you actually use for this model from the library. I will come back to that later. So for each of these functions, you need to specify the parameters. So in this case, the Euclidean function has the order and the lambda, the scaling factor parameter. You have to specify values. So this is actually all. So this in total, this part has to be copied almost literally to the software environment to let it run, and then it runs. If you design your model, you just focus on this. If you make a good picture of this, of these tables, then you're done, in fact. And then if you copy them to the software, it should run. Note that only this part should be copied, not that, of course. It's only these things that are really, the other ones are more the scales of the things that you use. So these are the things, this is in fact all things that influence your state X3, because it's not only these states that are connected that influence X3, also the connection weights influence X3, also the speed factor influences X3, also the choice of combination function and the parameters of the combination function, all of these things influence your state X3. And so they are all have some role in it. And these tables are called role matrices because they distinguish these roles. So they give what is the impact from other states, what is the impact from other weights. So these are different roles. And also the other ones. So therefore it's called role matrix. Is this clear? Is there any question about this? Okay. So that this is a kind of summary of what I just have told. So these tables, they form in fact 2D matrices, two-dimensional matrices, except this one, and I will show that in a while. So these are the state, there's always a state dimension in this way. So this is the states, that's one dimension. So in every row matrix, that's the same. Then we have other matrices. This is the incoming impact source dimension, you can say. It's the dimension in this direction. Here we have an incoming connection weight dimension in this direction. Here we have the speed factor dimension. That's a bit trivial because there's only one element. Here we have combination function dimension. And here, yeah, that's a bit different because now we have two things here. And that makes that this is not a 2D, two-dimensional matrix, but actually a three-dimensional. I will show it in a bit more detail. So we have this one, that's for the parameters of the combination functions. If in fact, it has, again, of course, the state dimension. And within this part, it has a parameter dimension because this is parameter one and this is parameter two of the function. But in the other one, it's again the same. You also have this parameter dimension. And then this is the third dimension actually, from one to the other. So that makes it a 3D matrix. And I'm just explaining this in a bit more detail because that also has consequences for how it's represented in MATLAB and how you should copy it. So that's, you should just be aware of this. I will show it in a minute, how it works to the software. So this is the part on some ideas about how to use the software. So that's the idea is that you have just the role matrix input as I have just shown, and then you get your simulation output, and that's actually what you want. So this is a magic box in a certain sense, and you don't need to open it except that you have sometimes to copy things in it and to set some certain values a bit. So for the design of your model, you just write down the role matrices as tables. And I always work in Word because you have nice layout options there, which makes it more nice. But you can also do it in Excel if you want. For simulating, just copy the raw matrices to the software environment in MATLAB and then press Run. That's the play button, say. So these raw matrices, we have these I've shown with the different, these are the input. And you can get an overview there. So that's probably you already have found it. So this is the place, there is one place in the software where you have to write MCF, this matrix for combination functions. Here you refer to numbers in the combination function library. So function 5, function 9, function 12, function 18. This is where you say, these are the only functions we use in our model. So usually there are just two or three of them. So this is important because after you have specified this, this is function 1 for your model, this is function 2, this is 3, and this is 4. So you don't use these numbers 18 and 12, for example, anymore. You have your own numbers for your own model. So 1, 2, 3, 4. So that's the important thing here. So then after this point, we can just use function 1, 2, 3, and 4. So then the fifth function, for example, is the a kind of homophily function that will come later, or Hebbian learning function. So anyway, so these are just functions that you can choose. let me see. So then you have this input. I will just use the example, this one. A very simple example. So you have to copy this into the software. And the software, you should be aware, MATLAB does not like strings or letters or whatever. MATLAB really likes the numbers. So therefore, in this case, you should leave out the X as a first step. And that's very easy in Word. You can just replace all in this area by nothing. If you replace X by nothing, then the X has disappeared and you only have the numbers. And MATLAB doesn't even care that the numbers are in subscripts then. So then you also have to fill the empty places, because that's another characteristic of MATLAB. MATLAB doesn't like empty places. So you always need to write something, and then MATLAB suddenly likes letters, because this NaN is a standard term in MATLAB. So the empty places, you can indicate them by NaN. So always fill your table completely, so that the empty places have the NaN, and now here the X's have disappeared. So this is the intermediate step before you copy it to the MATLAB environment, the software. So in this case, that step of leaving out X is not even needed, but the step to add these NaN, not the number indications, is still needed. So this is always needed. So that's one step. And then finally, from here, we can just go to the software. So this part, you have to just select that and do the copy it. Then you go to MATLAB, and someplace in MATLAB, you see these things. The matrix names is, and then between these brackets. And sometimes if it's already filled with an example, there is something written there. So you select that whole thing to delete it. And then in place, you copy it. So you put your cursor just between these two brackets, and then you do paste. That's all. So that's a kind of thing that the software receives, this matrix, because that's the one that you copied. And automatically MATLAB makes it like this. This becomes the MATLAB format. So it's very simple. You can just have the say graphical type of representation in Word or maybe Excel. And in this way, you copy it in MATLAB, and MATLAB immediately recognize it now like this. And that's how MATLAB then can work. As soon as MATLAB has the matrices in this form, then you can just play run. So the other one is then this one. And you do it for all matrices. So then for the combination function parameters, because there is a 3-day matrix in that sense, in that case, you have to be a bit more careful, a bit more precise, because of these three dimensions. And then you have construction that is, you always have to leave this cut. It should be there always. And also the three, don't change it by any other number, comma. And then you have each of these areas separately. So you have first this one, then you close it with such a bracket as well. And then you add the other one under it after a comma, and then just close it. That's all. So in that sense, for the parameter, the function parameter matrix, you have to do it in steps, depending on the number of functions you have. So for each function, you have to add such a thing. That can be also three or four, for example. But this number is always three, because that three, that means the three dimensions. So that there will always be three dimensions, not more. Okay, so this is the most difficult part maybe that we have until now, and it will not even play a role today, but in the assignment tomorrow, this may occur already. So that will be the total view of that combination function parameters values matrix. So this one is the first part and this is the second part. So that's all. For today, you even don't need to know this, but for if you want to make your own model for assignment one tomorrow, then that will be important to have some idea about this. So then we have the state dimension within this and the parameter dimension here. And then this is the combination function dimension, that step to that step. That's how MATLAB codes it. So there are some few small things you still need to give initial values. That's by the initial value factor. And then you can just play this icon and then it runs. Oh yeah, you also have to say how long do the end time of your simulation, your step size, often 0.5 is a good idea. If you have, you can, could have it one, but sometimes one is a bit too high, then the model can do strange things, but 0.5 is usually a safe choice. So for the course as such, I use an educational approach that's it's a bit well known because Benjamin Bloom is a very well-known educational scientist. And he introduced this approach, but in the academic world, it's not so known. So therefore I may need to explain it a little bit more because it's a bit different from approaches that are often used in other courses. So you can see some extra information on it on this Wikipedia site. So mastery learning assumes or states that you, for a good learning process, you should not be satisfied if students only know half of the skills. If you have 5.5 for a test, for example, then you may pass, but you only know half of the content. And so in fact, that's a kind of disrespect for the content of the course and for all of our time. So your time, my time, so why not do more? So that's the reason that Bloom states, well, it's much better if you aim at 90% for each part of what is to be learned. Of course, then people may react, yeah, but maybe some students cannot do that. Well, it turns out that in practice that's not true. Students can do many more things than sometimes it is thought. But the only thing is that you need to give more support, more additional feedback, more cycles of feedback. And that's actually what we do here. So you can get high grades, but we assume a high commitment so that you do a really effort to get things well and not be satisfied if it's only 60%, for example. And what maybe you have read on the Canvas site, you can go finally in the final assignment for a serious project that can have some originality that it can be published. And last year, 80% of the groups went for such projects, and 100% of all of them were accepted as a publication. So therefore you pose a high standard, but you also get high results. And on your CV, it's very nice if you have such a publication, if you are compared to other candidates that don't have that. So this is the basic assumption. So only for this year, I decided to make a small modification of that system. So also keeping in mind that you may already have a bit more difficulty now concerning all these corona issues. So now we have divided all assignments in two parts, a basic part, that's 70 to 80% of the assignment, and a more advanced part, the other 20 to 30%. And you have the choice for each assignment. You can choose to only do the basic part, then you can still have a grade that's sufficient, like 7 or maybe even 7.5 or maybe even 8. Or you can choose to do also the advanced part. And you can make the choice every assignment separately. So if there is an assignment where you like the advanced part, you just do it, and another assignment you don't do it. So then the score, if you only do this, it will be like between this maybe. But if you also do that, then you can be up to 10. If you do something in between, of course, your grade will also be in between. So that's your own choice. And for us, the commitment is that if you want to go for, at least for the basic part, we will help you to get the 90% of the basic part well. And if you want to go for the advanced part, we will help you to get also that for this 90% at least. But many students, is my experience, will go for the 100% even then. So you indeed can get very high grades in this course. But that's also how the system works, this mastery learning system. Helps you to get these high grades. And also hopefully a kind of satisfaction afterwards that you have achieved that, and maybe also you achieve this publication.